So welcome to this fabric part two, and I don't know if you guys had joined the previous session, that is part one, but don't worry, I'll just run through the content which I had delivered earlier. But you can see the recording of this, of the earlier webinars, on our YouTube channel. I will mention the YouTube channel and all the details of our recordings and everything at the end of the session. So let's get started. First of all, I'll introduce myself. So my name is Sanket Raikurkar, and I'm the blockchain engineer with Snapper Future Tech. So something about our company profile. So we are, of course, Snapper Future Tech, the leading blockchain technology and innovation startup. We were founded in 2016, so among the most promising companies in blockchain technology for consecutive 2 years by CIO Review magazine. We build products and solutions across healthcare, supply chain, banking and finance use cases and e-governance, and offer multiple blockchain-based services using Hyperledger and Ethereum platforms. So Snapper is a part of NM Tech Capital in Houston. That company has multiple startups under them, and those startups are working in different emerging technologies like IoT, AI, machine learning, and various other technologies. So it has also engineering services companies like Premises and BK Corrosion. So we have received awards and endorsement from CIO, Deep Tech, Hong Kong International Blockchain and Financial Association, and covered by different media platforms like Forbes, Daily Hunt, The Week, Economics Times. Yeah. So, and we have worked on many blockchain-based solutions like on supply chain, on e-governance, on healthcare and banking and financial. So in supply chain, we have our POCs on real-time goods traceability, luxury goods authentication. In e-governance, we have vehicle tracking and property records management. And in healthcare, we have drug traceability. And in banking and financial, we have insurance claims, loyalty rewards, certificate authentication and verification. So we have our own product, that is SnapCert. So it's a certificate, your university education certificate authentication and verification platform. So yes, so recently in the hackathon organized by Hyperledger India, our platform was used to give the certificates to the winners and participants of that hackathon. So in the last session, on the last webinar, I had talked about Hyperledger Foundation, Hyperledger projects, few of the Hyperledger projects, and fabric components. So I'll just run through what I had done in the previous webinar. So of course, I've talked about Hyperledger, which was founded by Linux Foundation in 2015 to advance cross-industry blockchain technologies. And Hyperledger is an umbrella project under the Linux Foundation. When was Hyperledger founded? So Hyperledger Fabric primarily. So it was founded in 12th July 2017. It came up with the Fabric 1.0 production ready version. Then I talked about various frameworks, tools and libraries in Hyperledger. The founding members of Hyperledger community. About the core principles of Hyperledger. So Hyperledger principles are based on modularity, highly secure, cryptocurrency agnostic, complete with APIs and interoperability. So yes, I talked about other frameworks also, but our focus is on Fabric, right? So Fabric was initially contributed by Digital Assets and IBM. So IBM is the major contributor in Fabric. And Fabric, and also talked about the consensus and MSP and something about channels and peers and organizations. Yeah. So So I had talked about that. So if you want, if you guys have any questions about consensus, MSP, certificate authority, you can ask me now if you want to, or you can ask in the chat. So it will be better you ask in the chat. Okay. So yeah, I talked about difference between Ethereum and Fabric. Talked about this in detail. Talked about these components of like peer organization, ordering nodes, MSP, Fabric CA, smart contract, asset, transaction, what is ledger, how many world states are used, like LevelDB and CouchDB. Talked about that, talked about channels. So today also we'll talk about channel and private data. Okay, talked about endorsement policy. Okay, MSP was done. So this was done in the last webinar. We had discussed about the ordering service. Like we have three kinds. So solo ordering service, Kafka, and Raft, right? So yes, so till the in the last part one, we had talked about this much. So today I'm going to talk about Ledger, channel, private data, endorsement policy, SDK. Yeah, so we'll see what is there in today's session. So about Fabric Ledger. So Ledger, you must be knowing that it's a blockchain is a distributed ledger technology, of course, and the ledger is shared among all the participants in the network. So likewise, the same way here also ledger is shared on all the committing peers. So I had told about the peers last time that there are two types of peers, endorsing peer and committing peers. So endorsers endorse the transaction, that means validates and signs the transaction, and committing peers commit the block, right, with them. So every peer is a committing peer, and but not all the peers are endorsing peers. So there are specialized roles given to some peers that is endorsing. Okay. So the Fabric Ledger is maintained by each peer and includes the blockchain and world state. So every peer, that is all the committing peers. So every peer is a committing peer, holds the ledger, and that is blockchain and the world state with them. So world state is the current, holds the current state of the holds the current valid state. Yeah. So a separate ledger is maintained for each channel that peer joins. So a peer can be a part of multiple channels. So inside one network, also there could be multiple channels, more than one channel. So that peer could be a part of that multiple channel. So that peer will hold the ledger, multiple ledger, more than one ledger, whichever it is a part, whichever channel it is a part of, it will hold that ledger. Okay. So it can hold one ledger, that means he's a part of one channel. If he's a part of more than one channel, that it will hold multiple ledgers. Okay. So a transaction read that sets are written to the blockchain. Channel configurations are also written to the blockchain. So the world state can be either LevelDB or CouchDB. So the LevelDB is the default world state database used in Fabric. CouchDB you will have to configure depending on how rich queries you are doing or how complex your queries are. So LevelDB is a simple key value store. CouchDB is a document store that allows complex querying. So the smart contract decides what is different to the world state. So you can define in the smart contract or chain code that what is to be written in the world state. Okay. So channel. So channel provides privacy between different ledgers. So ledger exists for one channel, that means one ledger. Okay. So channels can be shared across an entire network of peers. Channels can be permissioned for a specific set of participants. So doesn't matter here. We'll talk about this. Okay, I'll get back to your question later. Okay. So that depends on if when it's a public blockchain. So what happens here in the permissioned one, So Hyperledger is a permission, Hyperledger Fabric is a permission network. So we'll see how consensus, I will tell you how consensus work here, and doesn't matter 50% plus participants are malicious. I will see. So channels can be permissioned for a specific set of participants. Chain code is installed on peers to access the world state. So chain code needs to be installed on the endorsing peers. Okay, whichever peer is endorsing, it should hold the chain code with them, because whenever a transaction comes and needs to validate it, it requires peer chain code to verify what is the business logic. So ultimately, business logic is written in the chain code, right? So it needs to verify that, and endorsing peer has to hold the channel. Committing peer may not hold this smart contract or chain code with it, but it is not necessary that committing peer holds the chain code. Okay, so chain code is instantiated on specific peers. So you can instantiate your chain code or start your chain code on a specific peer. It can be one peer, it can be a two peer. That is not, defined. It may not be instantiated through all the peers. Any one peer in the network can be used to instantiate the chain code. Okay, so peers can participate in multiple channels. So your peer from your organization could be a part of more than one channel in the network. Okay, in one network. So something about private data. Okay, so last time I had not spoken about private data much. So somebody suggested that it should be taken up. So yes, private data. So in cases where a group of organization on a channel need to keep data private from other organization on that channel, so they have the option to create a new channel comprising just the organization who need access to the data. Okay. So however, creating separate channel in each of these cases creates additional administrative overhead. So administrative overhead, that means maintaining chain code version, policies, MSPs, and many more. And doesn't allow for use cases in which you want all channel participants to see a transaction while keeping a portion of data private. Okay. So that's why Fabric offers the ability to create private data collection. So every time you cannot create multiple channels, keep on creating channels to keep your data private. Okay. So that is why what Fabric offers is the ability to create private data collections, which allow a defined subset of organization on the channel the ability to endorse, commit, or query private data without having to create a separate channel. Okay, I hope you guys are getting what I'm trying to say here. Okay, so let me tell you what is private data collection. So a collection is the combination of two elements, that is actual private data and hash of the private data. So many of the times people ask me that if we keep our data private, then what about the rest of the peers? Do they have that data? That which I had said earlier, that every peer, it's a shared information, right? Blockchain, it's a distributed ledger technology. So even if the data is private, every peer or of that, every organization on that network or the channel will have that data. Okay, so what is actual private data? So actual private data sent peer to peer via GOSI protocol. So peers communicate with each other using GOSI protocol. So to only the organization authorized to see it. So this data is stored in the private state database on the peers of authorized organizations. So which can be accessed from chain code on these authorized peers. Okay. So the ordering service is not involved here and does not see the private data. Okay. So because of the gossip distributes the private data to peer to peer across authorized organization, so it is required to set up anchor peers on the channel and do some configuration on each peer. So in order to bootstrap the cross organization communication. So as I was talking about keeping the data with all the peers in the network, so a hash of that data which is endorsed and ordered and written to the ledger of every peer on the channel. So hash of the data is on the every peer on that channel. The hash serves as the evidence of the transaction and used for state validation and can be used for audit purposes. So keeping your data private doesn't mean that it is just private between the two peers or within the two organizations. So if and a subset of the data, the whole transaction is kept private, not the whole transaction. So you can still have the metadata of that transaction with the other peers. And about that transaction, which is private, the hash of that data is stored on the every peer in the ledger. Okay, on the ledger. Okay. All right. So that was about private data. So if you have any questions, you can ask. Moving on. So let's talk about chain code. So it is the business logic of blockchain application. So chain code is a program written in Go, Node.js or Java that implements a prescribed interface. So you can write your chain code in Golang, Node.js or Java, whichever expertise you have or whichever understanding you have of these languages. So chain code runs in a secure Docker container isolated from endorsing peer process. So in the previous session, we did talk about Docker container and Kubernetes and everything. So yes, Fabric runs in a Docker environment. So every peer, every certificate authority orderer, they run in a Docker, separate Docker container. So similarly, chain code also run in a separate Docker container. All right. So it doesn't depend on any peer which is running in another container. So it is independent. So if you have read about it, so in the Fabric 2.0 also, they have come up with something called as external launcher, which will run chain code in a separate environment. So yeah, let's not go into that, but chain code runs in a separate Docker container. So yeah. So chain code initializes and manages the ledger state to transactions submitted by application. So whenever an application submits a transaction, it goes on to check with the chain code and its business logic and check the functions written inside the chain code, and then it submits to the ledger. So Fabric chain code functions. So there is three types of main functions you can do in Fabric chain code. That is init or initialization or instantiation. So init is called during chain code instantiation to initialize any data. Upgrade also calls this function to reset or to migrate data. So whenever we are starting the chain code, that is instantiating the chain code, init function is called, and you can initialize data or you may not initialize data. That is not necessary to initialize any data. You can keep it empty. So upgrade, whenever you want to upgrade the chain code version, or you want to upgrade it, if you have read about in this upgrade in the official document, you must be knowing about, you can upgrade the chain code version. So upgrade also calls this function to reset or to migrate data. Second is the invoke function. So invoke is called when you want to call chain code functions to do a real transaction work. So invocation transaction will be captured as blocks on the chain. So whenever you want to push any data onto blockchain, that means you are invoking the transaction. Okay, you are calling that invoke function to push the data onto the blockchain. And query, as the name implies, query is called whenever you query your chain code state. Okay, let's continue. So I was talking about query. You can read data fixes of the blockchain using query. Okay, you query means you are returning, reading the values which is in the blockchain. So endorsement policies are defined which peers need to agree on the result of a transaction before it can be added to the ledger. So whenever a transaction comes for validation or signing, peers need to agree on the result of the transaction. So some peers are assigned to do the endorsing. So Fabric includes a small domain specific language for specifying endorsement policies. So for example, if a peer A, B, and C, and F must all endorse transaction of type T. So for example, if organization one has a peer A, organization two has a peer B, organization three has a peer C, and organization four has a peer F. So if I write a smart endorsement policy, so I write policy as if I want to make them all the endorsing peers, I write the policy that peer of organization one, that is A, and peer of organization two, that is B, and peer of organization three, that is C, and peer of organization four, that is F, has to endorse the transaction. So I can give my endorsement policy on the network level. We can define our endorsement policy while we are instantiating the chain code, or if we are using command line interface or CLI, then we can use this domain specific language by just specifying -p to that whenever we are instantiating the chain code. So like this, when you are using a CLI, you give -p, that is policy, and after that you define this endorsement policy. So like this, you define it. So then we have APIs, SDK for developing a blockchain application. So Fabric Shim provides the chain code interface, a lower level API for implementing smart contracts. So previously, in the previous version of Fabric, lower level APIs were used for implementing chain code. So Fabric Shim was being used, but now it is contract API, Fabric contract API, that is a high level API is used for application development. Okay, whenever we are writing the smart contract, so Shim is not being used now. Contract API is used. So every chain code program must implement the chain code interface. Apple Agent Fabric intends to offer number of SDKs for a wide variety of programming languages. So they have implemented SDKs in Go, Node, and Java. Okay, these three languages SDK we have in Fabric. So finally, we'll sum up with the transaction flow in Fabric. So this is a high level transaction flow from Fabric, which also I had talked about in the previous webinar, but I'll sum up this Fabric series with this final slide as a transaction flow. So when a client application submits a proposal through SDK, it goes on to endorsing peer, which ultimately validates the transaction, signs the transaction, then sends back the transaction to the client application. Then client application submits the transaction to the orderer. Orderer puts the transaction inside the block and then broadcasts the block to all the committing peers in the network. Okay, so this is the transaction flow in Fabric. All right. So as you can see. So yes, I'll copy this link. So finally, I had a demo, but that session has already been taken, and you can check that session on YouTube, on our YouTube channel, that is Indian Blockchain Institute. And I'll copy this link in the chat. All right. So any questions? Do you have any question? You can type it in the chat. I'll just open the chat. Okay. Oh, sorry. So Shreyas, what if the 50% plus users are malicious? So in the permission network, all the users are known. So the organization will know who is the malicious user if they do any malicious activity in the network. So and it is not possible also in public network, because they have to people, if there are 1 million nodes, then it is practically impossible to do malicious thing. So more than 50% people has to agree on that malicious transaction. So that is practically impossible. But no, the consensus works as a endorsing, ordering, and committing collectively. So I don't think that should be any problem. Because it is a permission network, so and chain code is deployed on the peer container, or it's deployed on the new container. So a new container, it's deployed on the peer network. Start a new container. It will start a new container, not the peer container.
Sankita, I have a follow-up question on that part. Asked this question. So let's say the chain code is getting installed on the new container. So, but command line, it is saying that on what particular peer we want to install that chain code, so that that peer can execute it or can consume it.
In that peer, you will have to instantiate the chain code, right? That is what it is. So, but ultimately, it creates a new peer container. So it's not that peer container which is already running. So for example, let's say peer 0 of organization 1 is being used to instantiate the chain code, right? So that peer 0 of organization 1 is running its container already in the network. But when you instantiate the chain code, it will create another chain code container which will run the chain code separately.
Okay. So then what is the use of the first peer container in that case for the organization one?
It also acts as a committing peer, right?
Okay.
So the logs will be there in that peer container.
Okay, got it.
Yeah. It also works as an endorsing peer, maybe, if you design it that way. So is SDK just node module? No. It's what does that mean? I don't know. Are you asking if SDK is just in a node? I didn't follow up that question. Fabric is used only for invoking the chain code installed on the peer. No. Fabric Contact API is for chain code interfacing. It's not to call any function. It is for chain code interfacing.
Sir, can you elaborate chain code interfacing a little bit?
So when you want to integrate your application to the front end, right? So you need that interfacing, right, to do, right? So whenever you are integrating your application, so that is chain code interface. That package is for that. Code stuff interface. So have you gone through any chain code? Have you written any chain code?
No, not yet.
Okay, so.
So we use the APIs to interact with the Fabric network.
Integrate with the, yes.
Okay.
Slides can't be shared, Mudit. You can watch this webinar on our Indian Blockchain Institute YouTube channel. Out in Fabric 2.0 version, if 3 organizations are in consortium, one creates a channel, the other one joins in channel if the chain code is stolen. So I have not run, I've just run first network in Fabric 2.0. I haven't worked deeply into that. So I cannot answer your question. I'll have to go through that. we can discuss this on LinkedIn. Okay, I'll have to check how this works. I haven't in Fabric 2.0. I did not work much, okay, practically.
Okay. I think one more. Okay.
Anything else?
You told that in private data, the transactions are not going to the order.
Sorry?
In two
private data, private data.
Our transactions are not going through the order.
Yeah.
But the block is stored into the block is stored in the block is stored block is created or not for that block is created.
Block is created.
So transactions should be empty for that block. Transactions redirect sets should be empty. Read and write. Good. Redirect sets should be empty.
I can't hear you. Can you?
I will type in chat.
So inside that SDK, you write APIs to integrate your blockchain network with the front end application. So that is SDK basically. So, Are Shreyas, please connect with me on LinkedIn. So if you want to know any opportunities in blockchain or anything you want to start with blockchain, please connect with me on LinkedIn, or you can mail me on this email ID. Okay. This is my email ID. Okay, so in private data, transactions are not occurring to order, but block is generated and also block has created. Okay. Yes, I mentioned ordering service is not involved here, but
how blocks are created if ordering service is not involved? So ordering service is the only thing the transaction should be ordered into the packaging into the blocks. So how blocks are?
But whenever a yes, it is stored inside a block, and but when we create a private data, we have in the private data collection we need to define that. Compulsorily that private data should wipe off after some amount of blocks, after some number of blocks. So according to DR, there's some rules and regulations by our government that
no.
There is some rule, GDPR rule, so you can go through. So it says that there is an option while creating private data collection that some block to leave. So if I write that after 15 blocks that private
No. Block to leave is okay, I got it. After some amount of blocks, automatically the data should be the purged. But here ordering services are here in private data, ordering service is not involved according to you are saying that. Yeah. But ordering service only can create the blocks. Then how the blocks are created in private data collections? If how the transaction should be coming or not in the block?
Yeah, the hash of that private data part will be stored. It will be stored. So So this
okay,
is
got
what it was given in the official document. So even I did not think about it. Why? So I will get back to you on this. Okay, I'm sure I will surely get back to you. They haven't mentioned it. Why? So let me go through it. Okay, I'll get back to you.
But also one thing, if the block is created, the read write sets are also coming or not?
Read write sets.
So for private data set with the private, it cannot expose it to others.
I'll get back to you on this. I'll have to check.
And also, can we create collections dynamically through chain code according to the input?
Yes.
According to the input, automatically the collection should be created or not?
No. We'll have to define the collection first.
N number of distributors, they have to create n number of collections.
Yes.
That should be the difficult, I think. I think if you know create a 1,000 number of collections, you need to predefine. But if you need a dynamically, it is possible.
That's right. I have no idea about how, if it is possible dynamically, I'll have to check. So we'll have to create like this
but
collection.
We know that this is, but we need a dynamic collection is possible. But we have the requirement is there.
I don't know if it's possible dynamically.
Okay, that is the doubt is, and also in Fabric 2.0 have the doubt, I already pasted here. If they have three organizations in a consortium, the war zone only the creator of the channel, war zone only in the channel. Remaining two organizations not in the channel, not joined in the channel, but they are in the consortium. But only war zone create the chain code package and it will be installed and it should be approved.
So, but when you were adding the organization, how did you add that organization? And where
but
did
the,
you add
the
organization?
They are all into the same concept, so you need to fetch the block. Directly fetch the block is working.
But
they are all into the same they are in the same consortium.
Okay. But
so automatically you need to fetch. It will work.
Let me ask you. Are you adding the organization in the running network or?
That is not my question. There are three organizations in the channel, in the consortium already. Only Awards One created the channel. Only Awards One created the channel. Only Awards One is joined in the channel.
Okay. So, which example are you using, first network?
No, I'm not using my first network. I'm using my custom network.
Okay.
In 2.0, I am building my custom network. I am created only one channel and only words only joined in the channel only. Chaincode package is created. Chaincode is installed in that organization in the peer. Chaincode is approved by the peer.
Okay.
But while committing the chaincode, while committing the chain code, it will throw the endorsement policy failure.
Okay.
But also one example is if a two or all three organizations in the channel, now I install this packages in all the organization, now it will work. But only one organization in the
Let me try this practically. Let me check. I haven't run Fabric 2.0 or tried to add the organizations.
Now everyone asking 2.0 outside for recruitment. That is a problem. I think 2.1 to the stable version.
Okay.
But in 2.0, orders should be distributed according to the channel.
Mm-hmm.
Then how only this channel should be in this order and this channel should be in this order? How we can achieve that?
So what I can do, what you can do is forward your query to Kamlesh Nagware. So you can also forward your query to Kamlesh Nagware in LinkedIn. So
okay.
So he might be able to follow you. So he is in our company. So I will also forward this to him. You can also. Yeah.
Okay. Not a problem. I have doubt regarding that. I am also facing the issues.
Yeah.
I deploy, I know multi-node I did in 1.4.2 complete in the cloud. While 2.0, I'm getting this issue. Endorsement policy failure. And there is a new life cycle, endorsement is coming in 2.0. The first network is predefined, that is the two organizations should be the fixed. But we have only the one organization, that only one organization should be in the channel.
Okay, definitely we'll see about, work on this and I will get back to you on this, okay?
Oh, okay, thank you.
Sure.
Thank you.
So, guys, yeah. Other questions?
Sanket, one question. Can you little bit explain about the capabilities and the policy which we configure in the config.tx for the org as well as for the channel?
Capabilities and
policies.
That. What we can do is I'm running out of time. So in the next webinar, we will talk about
okay. Yeah, sure. No worries.
Okay. We'll talk about this. So.
Yes. No worries.
Okay. If you have any queries, shoot me on LinkedIn or you can give me. Alright. Thank you very much for joining and do subscribe to our channel Indian Blockchain Institute.
You know, this is being something which is very astonishing to me, that as per several studies and reports, only 5-10% of the people are actually employable. By that, what I mean is that only 5-10% of the working class or the working people have the right skill set to be employed. And this is one of the major hindrances leading to unemployability. And the only way to overcome is upskill yourself. With rising competition, upskilling has become one of the key priorities. And understanding this fact, you know, IBI has come up with an exclusive program for the students, which we call it Blockchain Plus Internship Program. So this Blockchain Plus Internship Program will help you to learn in depth about blockchain technology, working on several projects, creating decentralized applications, along with an internship in Snapper Future Tech. So in this entire program, you're going to learn the entire product lifecycle development, what goes into enterprise grade applications and, you know, solutions and production. And this program is basically for students. This is about 2-3 months program, and it is a live instructor-led program. So any person from around the world can participate in this program, can sign up, and will also get an internship appointment letter with Snapper Future Tech. So you're gonna work with the industry-leading faculties, you're gonna get a lot of mentorship during the program, and also get a lot of hands-on experience to learn about creating your own product. So even if you're looking forward to be an entrepreneur, this is the right program for you, because you know what goes into the product development, what is the thought process, what kind of a business model you should think about, and most importantly, how is the product lifecycle development. You need to always hear your customers out. So this program is exclusively aimed at students, primarily freshers who are looking forward to land their dream job and build their career in the technology space. So blockchain is one of the most paid skills in demand. It's the number one skill in demand. It's the best time to learn blockchain. And this is only one of a kind industry program which will help you not only learn, but also get internship. So at the end of the program, you're going to be evaluated by your faculties and get an internship letter from Snap of Future Tech, which is one of the leading enterprise blockchain companies. So this program will cover Ethereum, Hyperledger, and also internships. You're going to learn a lot of about Ethereum, which is a public blockchain, Solidity, how to create decentralized application, create your own tokens, write your own smart contracts, along with Hyperledger ecosystem and how to create Go, create a network. You are going to learn about Golang, Kubernetes, Dockers, and so on and so forth. So this is really, really exciting program. This program is exclusively for you. So please sign up, as we have limited seats available for this. Thank you so much and have a good day.